Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of KigerCraft. I'm Ty Gorso, and I'm here with Garen, and today we are going to be having a little fun with TNT. Mwahahaha. We're just using TNT as an excuse to build a farm. Because, as you can see over here, I have my sound turned down now, we're kind of over full on cows. So, we're going to build a little space for them. We're also going to move this downstairs as well. So that way we have plenty of room for doing all of the things. But we're going to go down about 15 or so. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4. Oops. Oh no! I'm glitching out. Alright, there we go. Alright, so let's see. I'm down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Well, I think I started on 63. So that would be 12, 13, 14, 15. There we go. Ah, I can't hear the cows anymore. It's nice and peaceful and quiet. All right. So we'll just go ahead now that we got some room here. Oh, I know. I'm just making this easy to get down. So that way we have an easy way to get in and out. I ran out of ladders. Sorry. All right, there we go. So this is where we're going to be starting. Let me turn my sound back up here. There we go. And we don't need that anymore. So this is going to be the back corner, and we are going to be blasting today because blasting is fun. We think that we're going to be doing this as a sort of a montage, but we're not entirely sure just yet. So you guys will know, because by the time you see this, we would have already decided on what we're going to do. There we go. All right. So I feel really claustrophobic in too high spaces, so I'm going to cut out a little bit more here, and probably by the time we're done here, my pickaxe is gonna break on me. It's getting kind of low, but I did do some enchanting the other day, and I'm really excited because I got an infinity bow, so that's gonna be my first one. So it's gonna be super exciting. We're just gonna get this here. There we go. And so I'm gonna take this time to show you kind of what the formula we're going for is. We've got a 3x3 space here. We're going to punch out. Oh, actually, you know what? Hold on a second. Where are the cows? I think the cows are this direction. I don't think we want to go this direction because this will lead us under the castle. Let me go check here real quick. Okay. Oh, actually, you know what? No, I think Garen's right. So, over on my left. Yeah. Nope, that's right. Garen's right. We're going to dig out 3x3 areas. We're going to put a grass block in the middle and then the TNT on top of it. And then all the way down the rest of the way. And that is supposedly going to allow us to make a chain reaction. So when we set off the one TNT here, it'll continue on down the row and it'll blow up all the rest of them. So that's the plan that we've got going for today. And get a little bit of light in here. Ooh, looks like we got massive amounts of coal. You guys saw the other day from the ABBA rules that we did that, oops, I think I messed this up already. It's 1, 2. Two on either side. Oh yeah, I went too far. from the ABBA rules that we did the other day that I lost pretty bad. So I'm actually kind of hurting for resources. So we're going to try and gather up as much of what we find as we can. Just because it'll be good. Alright. So we're going to dig out this last one here. And then we're going to do our first round of blasting. And we're going to see how it goes. But the topic of the day today is going to be the end of Ultra Hardcore. If you haven't, I probably just spoiled it right there if you haven't seen it already, so my apologies for that. But if you haven't seen any of the least recent episodes, people, you should have seen it because it's actually been a while. I'm sorry. It's been a while, so let me get these leaf boxes. Can I have a leaf box? That way I can start setting up the TNT. There we go. So I'm going to give you some time now to, cover your ears if you haven't seen the next few episodes, but it's been a while. I was supposed to talk about it the other day, but I actually went on an hour-long talk, so I kind of blew it at that point. So I will be talking about it today. So there we go. All right, and pretty much, Etho won the whole thing. I wasn't really surprised, but the way that he did it was pretty surprising. He essentially went through and went on an ultra kill and killed pretty much everyone. He did really well. At the end there, he got Beef. He got MC. He got a lot of people. So, congrats to Etho. I believe this is actually his first time winning, so that he must be really excited about that. There we go. So I'm super happy for him, because everybody who competes really deserves to win. I know that we root for certain people, some more than others, but we all really like all of the people who compete. So whenever any of them win, it's always a sweet, sweet victory. It's, I think the most exciting part about it is to see how the people die. Are they killed in PvP? Are they killed in, you know, by a glitch? You know, it's the whole thing is just super exciting to watch. So the outcome is good either way. Okay. There we go. But yeah, Etho won. Alright. Oops, that's not what I wanted. But he got so many people right there at the end. It was actually kind of shocking. I've never seen somebody go on a killing spree quite like that in Ultra Hardcore before. Though one of the things that I was thinking to myself, and other people had thought about as well, is like, man, if Paz was here, it probably wouldn't have happened. Because Paz usually seems to kill Etho. So, okay, it looks like we're getting ready for our first light. Do you have a flint and steel? Can I set off? Alright. Now, Gearin here wanted everybody to have a little reminder that only you can prevent forest fires. Now let's go blow some stuff up. Alright. There we go. Oop. Oop. Cool. Oh. Looks like we got a survivor over here. Okay, we're going to go ahead and light this place up a little bit, just so that we don't have monster spawning or anything like that. We're a little too close for monster spawns, but you never know. But let's just go ahead and let's just set this last one off here. Alright, there we go. Drop my flint and steel. There we go! The first round of explosions. Alright. Let's clean this up a tidbit here. Okay, we went down a little bit more than I had thought we would, but that's okay. Doesn't really matter. I wanted to have kind of a high ceiling, because we are going to be putting redstone lamps in here. It's going to be a light-based gathering system for the wheat that we're going to have down here. So I did want to have plenty of room. What is this? Oh, Giran's replacing blocks with cobblestone. Oh, okay, I see. Oh, you didn't do that? How weird. I wonder if we blasted into one of my old mines or something like that. Oh well, it's not like I was really using it, and I want to be down lower, way lower than this anyways, so not really that big of a deal. Alright, there we go. But yeah, unfortunately, one of the last people that Etho ended up killing was our boy, Vintage Beef. He saw Etho in the desert and attacked him. It was really an exciting fight. I really enjoyed it. I really wish Beef would have come out on top and that he would have done some things differently. He did make... I hear a zombie. We must be near a cave or something. He did make a few mistakes in that last fight that I think cost him the fight. But, you know, we can't blame him. We love Beef, and you know, coming up against Etho. Etho is good at Minecraft. He wouldn't be so popular if he wasn't. So, you know, we can't really blame him for that. All right. Let's see and get rid of some of this. Yeah. There we go. So, you know. Pretty much what happened with Beef is he ran into Etho in the desert, and he was fighting him long range. They weren't hitting each other because they were pretty far away. And what ended up happening, I guess, was Pyro saw them and decided to take an advantage. By attacking Etho while he was busy trying to kill Beef. And Etho took a bit of damage from Pyro, I think. It was just a few hearts. It wasn't very much. But the problem was is that Beef actually attacked Pyro while he was trying to kill Etho. And the whole time I was just like, no, what are you doing? Let him live. I mean, you know, I can't really blame him. I mean, you know, the ultra hardcore is pretty high stakes and high stress as well. So, you know, mistakes are bound to happen. But I think things really would have turned out differently if, Beef would have, done, and I'm definitely doing the armchair quarterback here. But what I probably would have done, or wanted Beef to do, is to let Pyro attack him and then run off in sort of like a counter-flanking position. Oh, okay, we just gotta be careful. In sort of like a counter-flanking position around the backside of Etho, so essentially losing... Oh, is he? Oh. What's up, buddy? Alright, let's get rid of this guy, because I don't know what he's going to do to TNT. Alright. Got him. These Endermen aren't too hard. But I really wanted Beef to kind of go into a counterflanking position, kind of behind Etho. That way, Etho would have lost track of him. The thing was is that Beef stayed in the same position. He didn't move all that much. He couldn't see Etho from where he was. And when Pyro died, he kind of tried to attack him. And he ran at him head on, but he just got shot in the face. So I was bummed out, especially since Etho just regained all of his hearts because he had tons and tons of gold, and then from the people he killed, he also picked up more gold from them. And then excitement, MC Gamer. Bounces up and attacks Etho with a flint and steel, which is something that it's kind of like an underrated weapon in ultra hardcore. All right, so we're ready for another round. All right, here we go. Yeah. All right. This floor keeps getting lower and lower. That's all right, though. We'll fix it. Get this coal. But flint and steel is actually a very underrated weapon. People opt for swords, but in several of the ultra hardcore seasons, people have used flint and steel to great effect. MC had, I think, not a lot of life. When he attacked Etho, but he still did significant damage. I think he with his flint and steel, did more damage to Etho than both Pyro and Beef did. So that was very interesting. And at first, it was kind of crazy because we were watching from Etho's perspective. You know, we were like, oh, does he have like a fire aspect sword? But no, it was a flint and steel because we turned around and saw the fire on the ground. So that was very, very good, strategy on, MC's part. But it was unfortunate because there was a lake, right behind Etho, so all he had to do was backpedal into the lake. I actually think that MC would have killed Etho if that lake had not been there. Just because he had done so much damage and Etho was on fire. And, you know, you can burn for quite a while. And because I think you can die from fire like that. So, it was definitely kind of like a, oh. But now Etho, to his credit, was very quick on his feet and jumped into that lake very quickly. So, so he avoided death and eventually moved on to win. Though one of the surprising things was, the last two people were Etho and Packrat, which was like, Packrat, really? So he actually managed to survive the entire way. Okay, hold on a second. Do you think we should start widening it out this way? Because this is actually pretty narrow, so I think maybe we should go along that wall and blast it out more that way. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. So I'm going to lay the TNT. Oops. Because we only have a limited amount of TNT. We had about 52 to start with. There we go. And I think I'm happy with the length. All right, so let's go ahead and bust through this wall here. Oops. Nope, don't want to do that. All right, there we go. Bust through this wall. Need a little bit of light. Sorry, guys. Sorry about the being dark. But yeah, I guess we can forget about the montage. We're just gonna do this. The blasting is fun. I'm sure you guys aren't going to complain about seeing TNT go off. So, yeah, Pack Rat was the last one, and he actually, he got seen, or he was seen by Etho in their showdown in the forest. So that was, one, two, three. So he kind of was seen, and Etho lost track of him because, Pack Rat actually, dug down. He knew that Etho had found him, so he immediately went underground, which actually was a pretty good, strategy. Etho, where the heck? Oh, there he is. So Etho, lost track of him for a little while, and, it was a perfect time to kind of come back up around Etho, but Etho had moved, so Pack Rat lost track of him. So they lost track of each other, and then Etho was able to see him first because Pack Rat gave away his position by Etho laid down some lava. There we go. Some lava under above the hole that Pack Rat had dug down, and so what ended up happening was is that the forest caught on fire, and Pack Rat remarked about how he had burned down the forest and killed a sheep with the fire. So that caused Etho to turn around, and then he saw Pack Rat hiding by a tree, and that was pretty much it. It was over at that point. Alright, I'm just gonna beat this out. Here we go. Alright, I am out of leaves. Yay, leaves! You got my own little bear fountain. Alright, there we go. Alright, so are we ready to blast? Alright, here we go. Go, tap, tap, tap. A little bit delayed. Oh, we got this one over here. Let's set these off. Boom. There we go. Not bad, not bad. Exposing some good amounts of material here. Alright, there we go. Going, yep, Garen's digging that up. So, we need to clear out. I think this is looking pretty good. I think this is gonna work out pretty nicely. There we go, put that back there. Alright. So yeah, definitely an exciting season this year. Lost a lot of people to lag and glitches. But what I like to see is that, you know, there are up-and-comers, you know? It's not just the same people every year who are gonna win. You know, the who's playing is definitely an important dynamic as far as ultra hardcore goes. You noticed it definitely this season with the absence of Paws and Paws. Etho got the majority of the kills, and it's usually Etho that gets killed by Paws, and Paws does most of the PvP killing. It was definitely different. And also there were a lot of new people who had a good showing. Michael had a good showing. Milby kind of got jumped early on, so hopefully he'll come back for another round and we'll be able to see what he's got. But you know, definitely, you know, they're going to take these experiences with them into the next season, and the next season hopefully is going to be even better. So we can hardly wait. I mean, we're complete UHC junkies. We love watching these guys kill each other for fun and profit. So that'll be exciting. There we go. But nothing is as exciting as blowing things up with TNT. Having so much fun right now. I hardly ever use TNT. So this is actually a rare treat. Gather all this up. We have 11 TNT left. So we're gonna have to start getting precision about how we clear this out. Because we don't have any of the gunpowder left. So once the stack is gone, that's it. Alright, are you ready? Alright, here we go. Next round. Go! There we go. All right, light it up a little bit. Actually, I'm thinking this is good. This is definitely gonna be enough room. I did want a large area. But I'm thinking that we're gonna have to drop this floor down to make it on like this sort of level. I think that'll be good. That'll give us a nice tall ceiling. That'll give us lots of stuff to play with. And then we'll just fill in these gaps with cobblestone. So done blasting for today. That was exciting. I like blasting. So when I get my eventually I want to set up a mob farm. Oops. Just burn the place down. Eventually I want to set up a mob farm, so that way I can have unlimited amounts of TNT and my own sort of harvest for other things that mobs drop, like arrows and bones and things like that from skeletons. Definitely fun to work with TNT. So if you got to clear out a big area, TNT is the way to go. And doing it in the 3x3 with the chains definitely makes it a lot easier. Because TNT, when I had used it previously, I had always thought it was a little bit unpredictable. I could never really, you know, figure out how to use it in a proper way to where it was safe and controlled. But this is actually much, much better. Let's grab all this stuff. Can't let any of this stuff despawn. I need it all. There we go. My inventory is happy. And it's raining outside, apparently. But yeah. Progress is coming along on the Ender Farm. Because I know a lot of guys have been asking about that. We will be doing that in an episode. We're probably going to take a couple days to record that just because it is such a big project. But we haven't set aside time for it yet. We will be needing a lot of materials. In fact, this is actually one of the reasons why we're making this area. Because we're going to need wool and things like that. So we need to kind of have an area where we can have sheep and, jeez, I'm terrible at placing blocks, where we can have sheep and different things, cows for food and leather. It would also help a lot with trading with the villagers, because we've got a bunch of butchers and they want raw beef to trade. Go ahead and get rid of all this. Don't want any of this junk. There we go. So the villagers will definitely benefit from this. We will benefit from it in the form of emeralds. So yeah, that's another benefit, but we do need the sheep. The wool will definitely be a huge help with the ender farm. There we go. Yes, I know it's dark. There, are you happy, Minecraft? Alright, looking good, looking good. Gather all this up. We'll immediately recycle this. But in another sort of sad news point, I heard today is Saturday. You guys will be seeing this on Sunday, so you'll probably have heard this, but Neil Armstrong died. He was the first man on the moon and one of only a very small number of not just Americans, but of humans who have done something as extraordinary as be on the moon. His death is something that makes me really sad because we don't have a lot of people like him. I mean, I really wish that, you know, since we went to the moon in the 60s, late 60s, early 70s, that we could say that we have more than just a few people that have been to the moon. But I can't, and that makes me really sad. I don't really think that he should be as rare as he is, but he was an amazing person. I actually went and read his Wikipedia article, and he has actually done a lot more stuff than just being the first man on the moon. I think of all the things that it lists on his Wikipedia article that he has done in his life, I think any one of those things would be an accomplishment for someone. Oh, don't fill the ceiling? Okay. So his loss is a great loss for us all. So hopefully, you know, he'll always be the first, him and Buzz Aldrin, but hopefully we can say that, you know, he wasn't one of the last. So that will give us a total of 8 astronauts who are left from the Apollo missions. There originally were 13. Several have died, and that leaves us with just 8. It's either 13 or 12. Yeah, it's 12. There was 12 total across all the Apollo missions. So, yeah, not exactly the brightest day, but he was pretty old. He died of complications from heart surgery, I believe it was. And that's just what happens. But he did a lot of great things for science, for America, and for space travel, so he will always be remembered. And hopefully, I hope that, you know, news about his death will maybe inspire someone else to rise up to the challenge of space and meet it as he did. So, yes, now we will lay down dirt, which I don't have. So that's gonna be pretty boring, so we're probably gonna do that off camera. And welcome back, everybody. We've been doing a little bit of work off camera, but we wanted to show you guys what we've done. We filled in the entire floor with dirt, and we've started work on the lighting system. We had to bring the ceiling down a little bit because we're gonna have the lamps up here. And all the smooth stone you see is where the wiring is going to be, because all this is going to be smooth stone. It's just cobble for right now because I don't have enough smooth stone. But the lamps are going to be here. Garen's upstairs working on it right now. I'm working on getting the farmland going, but we had to drop down the ceiling a little because it was an absurd amount of lamps that were required to light this place up. But we did a little bit of calculations, and we figured out how exactly where and how many lamps we need. This here is going to be our wheat farm. We're putting the wheat farm up close to where everything is, or to the entrance at least, because the cows are also going to be down here, and the cows are loud. So we're going to have them in the back over there. And the way that the water works here is I just have one water source block, and one water source block will hydrate a 9x9 square. So that's 4 in each cardinal direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then the block, and then in each diagonal direction as well. So it does, and actually a pretty big area. So I'm just counting these out right now. There we go. This one goes on the wall. Oops, forgot my water. But we're almost done, so I'm pretty excited. I've got plenty of whatchamacallem seeds left over from the tiny little wheat farm I have upstairs. So we'll be able to, should be able to get most of this planted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. There we go. So we're getting close to being done here, but there is one more thing I wanted to talk about, and that is the Apple and Samsung patent infringement case. The jury came back with a verdict, and it was definitely not good for Samsung. They found Samsung willfully infringed on some of Apple's patents, which means that that's very bad news. And this here. Oh, I hear skeleton. So what it means is that Samsung lost, and Samsung lost really badly. Let's see, I think I can fit another 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There we go. So the whole thing is completely ridiculous. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The patents that Apple has and we're suing Samsung for supposedly infringing on are completely ridiculous. They said that the patent that is the quote-unquote bounce back is what they're calling it. Pretty much what it is when you pull back a menu on a mobile phone and it's overdrawn. Oops, I actually think that this is going to be part of the pen. But when you pull back a menu and it bounces back, Apple was able to patent that, that UI element. So Samsung on the first Galaxy S was apparently infringing upon that. Okay, we're just going to start tilling here. So they lost on that. They also lost on an equally ridiculous patent for the contour of the back part of the Galaxy, the original Galaxy S. They said that the contour, like the curvature of the back of the phone, was violated Apple's patents, which I think is absolutely preposterous, because how can you, you know, patent the contours? That's like saying you're the only one that can have an aerodynamic car. Pretty ridiculous. But they lost, so the jury awarded Apple a little over $1 billion. Yes, that's $1 billion with a B, dollars for supposed quote-unquote lost sales and trade dress issues. Yeah, it's pretty serious. The patent system is completely broken. That's pretty much all that there is to it. Yes, absolutely. I've talked about this before, and Garen makes a good point. The Mojang has been suffering from patent trolls. There's a company that has a patent for a really generic method of preventing unauthorized access to paid software. And if that doesn't make sense to you, don't worry, it doesn't make sense to me. I had to actually go and read the patent to find out what the hell it actually was, and it turns out that it's anything with a login screen. Yeah, like anything. If you had to pay to get into a site that had that has content, they're technically infringing on that patent. So, really generic, really ridiculous. But that's how broken our patent system is. It's not Apple's fault for patenting it. It's the system's fault for enabling them to do so. To give a little bit of context, all right, cool. This is working out. I'm going to put down a couple fences here because I don't want the cows to get out. But to get a little context into what other countries do, in Korea, Samsung sued Apple for patent infringement on one of their patents. Samsung won and was subsequently awarded $35,000. Yeah, that's it, $35,000. And if you infringe on a patent in the U.S., you apparently get $1 billion. So, let me get my door here. Oop. So, pretty silly, pretty ridiculous. This is actually a huge problem because this now opens up the field so that Apple can go and sue just about any company that it likes. The whole Samsung Apple thing is more or less a proxy war for Apple versus Google because of the Android operating system. That's really what Apple wants to see go away. Steve Jobs, when he was alive, did not mince words with how he feels that Android completely rips off the iPhone OS, but you know, I just don't think that, you know, how curved or glossy an icon is something that you can really patent. I think it's just absolutely ridiculous. But yeah, that's that. So I've got a switch here. So we're going to power on the lights for the very first time. There we go. And boop. Yay. It works. So now, we just need to till the rest of these. It's ready to go. Our wheat farm is fully functional. I'm not going to grow anything down here on camera. I'll wait until next time and I'll show you guys how it works. But the cows are ready. We're going to bring some grass down in here. I'll just break these. We have a silk touch. So we'll eventually get some grass down here, because people say that I'm already cruel enough to the villagers. I don't want to be cruel to the animals as well, so. Whoop, let's close that. And I'm going to take you guys, oops, damn it. Got to remember, can't bounce on farmland. No bouncing. We're going to take just a quick tour of the redstone up here. It's actually really simple. So there's a switch here that powers all of this redstone, and then the redstone gets powered onto the lamps. So as long as the redstone is pointing inward to the lamps will get powered. Oh wait, no, that's not necessarily true. Giren's gonna correct me here. Yeah, it powers the block it's on, so as long as the block is next to this, like this, it'll get powered. But you'll see here, we actually have a couple repeaters because once the signal gets too weak, like it is right here, it has to be boosted. So that's how we do it. We do it with repeaters. But yeah, it just keeps going and going and going. We've got torches up here to prevent things from spawning. But yeah, it's a pretty simple setup. So there we go. One switch to rule them all. And there we go. Alright, so we are done. We're gonna go plant our stuff, and somehow, I don't know how, but we're gonna move the cows down here. So thank you all for joining us again. We hope you enjoyed this episode of KigerCraft, and we will see you next time. Bear, take care.